I am unconditionally loved by God and that harvest. I come to him as I am, but I won't stay as I am, because the message I'm prepared to receive will make me more like the great I am. I am blessed and I am favored in Jesus' name. You can be seated. We're going to take a look at what the movie is this week. Amen. Hallelujah to the Lamb of Jesus, the Christ, God. Amen. If you were here at the 9:15, you know why I'm saying all of that. Amen. 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 Because we don't want Bishop Nino Brown to have to come out. Well, shoot, I hadn't told. Okay.
Living, living, just enough. Living, just for the city. Living, 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 just enough. And now we're living, living, just enough for the city. Living, living, living. New Jack City. Boom, boom, boom. Do things, bad things, but then. Do things, bad things, but then. Almighty dollar. Oh, keep saying that. People don't let money. Don't let money change you. You keep on changing, changing, changing up your mind. Don't let money change it. For love of money, people will steal from their brother. For love of money, people will rob their own mother. Money, 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 money. Just enough. For the city I'm living, just for the city I'm living, just enough for all the city, just enough for city, living, just enough.
Well, you know the movie we're getting ready to do today. Look at your neighbor and say, you're going to learn a lot. Father, now in this moment, I decrease that you might increase. Speak to us now with clarity, Father. We thank you that you are God that can even use movies, even movies that show, unfortunately, some of the negative that exists in our society. There's a principle, even in every problem, even in every plight, there is a principle that we can learn and that we can move in and that we can grow from. Speak to us now in the name of Jesus. Somebody shout hallelujah. You're already seated, but encourage somebody on your left and right. Tell them you're going to need this word today. You're going to need this today. Now, Jesus taught with stories that illustrated principles. These were called parables. Say parables. And in this series, we're using movies as parables to illustrate biblical principles to us. Now, for today's movie, we're going to look at four different principles from the same movie. Now, FYI, if you've never seen the movie, I want to be clear that this is a grown folks only type of movie. Look at your neighbor and say, grown folks only. Now, Denver, in case you don't know what grown folks only means, that means this is the kind of movie where you have to send the children upstairs or to another room. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. If you grew up in the South, there were certain things where y'all say, all right, this is for grown folks. This is one of those kind of movies, but this movie has lots of principles in it that I want to use to illustrate these biblical principles to us today. The first is this. Say, first principle. We're in a new era. An era, by definition, is a span of time with distinct change. New Jack City is about the rise and fall of a New York City drug lord. His name was Nino Brown, who was played by Wesley Snipes. His fall came at the hands of a New York City detective called Scotty Appleton, who was played by Ice-T. Somebody say Ice-T. And some of y'all remember who Ice-T was. I'm not talking about Sweet Tea or Ice-T from the restaurant. That was his stage name. Now, the movie showed an era in culture, which was the crack epidemic of the late 80s. The crack came on the scene as a way for people to cope with the plight of the destructive political and economic policies of the day. It even introduced an era in music called New Jack Swing music. Some of you remember New Jack Swing music. You saw the group singing. They were a New Jack Swing kind of people. I think that was LaVert singing and some other folk singing there in that. Say a new era. Talk 11:15, say a new era. Now, when recruiting Scotty to take down Nito, Scotty's commanding officer, who was played by Mario Van Peebles, said this: "We've got a New Jack City and we need a New Jack cop." In other words, he was saying, listen, crack came on the scene and we can't handle this problem the way that we've been handling every other problem. Can I talk to you about your life? There's some stuff that's been showing up in your life that you can no longer handle the way you used to handle it. He said, "We got a New Jack City and we need a New Jack cop." In essence, he was saying, we're in a new era. Say new era. And when Jesus came, Jesus announced that a new era had begun. It was the era of the kingdom. Say the kingdom. Matthew 4:17 says this: "From that time Jesus began to preach and say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." That word repent means to change your mind, change your way of thinking. Stop wasting your life. Stop wasting your time. Stop living your life like you're not going to have to give an account for it one day. He said repent. Somebody say repent. That word in Hebrew literally means to change directions. He was saying, you've been headed this way, but in an instant, I need you to shift into the direction that I am moving you into, and it is called the kingdom. Please understand, he said the kingdom is at hand, which means it's in reach. Somebody say it's in reach, and I can grab it. Come on, 11:15, say it's in reach, and I can grab it. Can I tell you, there's some stuff that seems really far away from you. And the truth is, it is not that far away from you. It is at hand, meaning it is at reach. You think it's going to take God 10 years. I'm going to tell you, we serve the God of the impossible. What you think will take 10 years, God can do in 10 minutes. What you think will take 20 years, God can do in 20 minutes. Somebody say, it's at hand. Now, please understand, the kingdom literally means heaven's attributes on earth. Many people, if you grew up in church, you were always taught to keep your mind on things eternal, which does not, watch this, it was misinterpreted through the process of time, because most people thought that meant that we need to not worry about anything going on here, because one day we're going to die and get over there. But that's not what Jesus taught. Jesus said that the kingdom is heaven's attributes on earth, which means we're not trying to die to get over there. We're living well to bring over there down here. It is called heaven's attributes on earth. Somebody say, that's kingdom. It is God's MO, God's modus operandi. It is how God does what he does. And I made it real simple for you several weeks ago. I made it simple and told you that the kingdom is simply who God says you are and what God says you can have. Say, it's who he says I am and what he says I can have. I'm here to tell you, Jesus did not die just for you to get a get out of hell free card. And too many people get saved from hell and they live in hell on earth. But I came today to tell you those days in your life are over, because you're in a new era. Somebody say new era. And whenever God was announcing a new era, he would send a man of God to proclaim that the era was changing. Well, I'm going to tell you, you're not at Harvest by accident. You are here because I've been divinely sent to announce to you that a new era is beginning in your life. And it is the era where you finally become who he says you are, and you finally have what he says you can have. He says, I am come that they might have life, and that they might have life more abundantly. You were not created to struggle. You were not created to be jacked up all your life. You were not created to be messed up all your life. You are the curse break. You are the interruption to the dysfunction of your bloodline. I'm telling you, it's a new era. Somebody holler, new era. You better get used to not struggling anymore. You better get used to not having lack anymore. You better get used to walking in everything God ordained. You better get used to more good days than your bad days. You better get used to your body being healed. You better get used to your family coming in order. You better get used to it, because we're in a new era. Watch this. God brings us out of various Egypts, bondage. Egypt in the original Hebrew, it simply means narrow, confined. He brings us out of bondage. Say bondage. To take you into various manifestations of the kingdom. Now, here's what's interesting. When we say manifestations of the kingdom, oftentimes in the church, we talk about promises of God. And for a lot of people, that's this aloof subject, because we say promises of God. Well, what does that really mean? You ever wondered that? Somebody said, I'm just going to possess the promises of God. And you ever wondered, like, what are you talking about? Come on, be honest. You're like, okay, that's nice, but what does that mean? A promise just simply is a manifestation of the kingdom. Say manifestation of the kingdom. Well, what is the kingdom? Heaven's attributes on earth. It is who God says you are, what God says you can have. Now, check this out. This is important. This is important. Because many people, they like the God that gets them out of Egypt, but they've not met the God that takes them into the promise. You know the God that can get you off of the drugs, but now you need to meet the God that can use your history to be somebody else's testimony. You know the God that can get you out of the alcohol, but now you need to meet the God that's going to take those days so that you can brighten somebody else's days. You know the God that can get you through the struggle, but now you need to meet the God that can get you to a surge. You know that God. You know the God that, I feel like preaching here. You know the God that can pay bills and you don't have all the money. You know the God that can heal you when the doctors say you can't be healed. But God says, I didn't just take you out. I want to also take you in. And too many Christians get satisfied with coming out of, but they never walk into. So they stay in the wilderness. Ooh, but Jesus, I came to announce to you that from this day forward, a new era is coming in your life. Somebody holler, a new era. Watch this. He brings you out of various Egypts. Now, here's the trip about it. You can have certain areas of your life that are in a different place than other areas of your life. You can be doing great financially, but be doing horribly emotionally. Have you ever experienced the dichotomy of life where certain areas are so great that it makes you want to shout? And certain areas are so wretched, it makes you want to holler, but not a good holler. It makes you... You ever been happy about this breakthrough, but then as soon as you turn your head, all you saw now was another problem? You ever had 99 problems? Here's the deal. You can be in Egypt in certain areas of your life, and you can be possessing the promise in other areas of your life. It is quite an interesting dichotomy that we sometimes experience in life. And most people have been brought out, but they're not walking into who he says you are, nor do you have what he says you can have. And the number one reason is because you do not do what you're told. Now, I realize it might get quiet for the next few moments, and that's only the rebellion in you getting kicked up out of you. I said, it's a kick out spirit, and we're going to kick the rebellion up out of your life. Now you said, Bishop Foreman, what do you mean? I'm going to show you something. Now, Deuteronomy 6:23. Then he brought us out from there that he might bring us in. Well, now watch this. Might means maybe, which means it's conditional. What you need to know about God is while his love is free, possessing the promise has a fee. That he might bring us in to give us the land which he swore to our fathers. Verse 24. And the Lord commanded us, watch the connection, to observe all these statutes, to fear the Lord our God. That means reverence for our good always. Look at me. He said, there are some regulations and protocol in place. And he said, God told us to follow the protocol because when we follow the protocol, it's for our good always. If you're somebody that always likes to break the rules, you're violating the text because the text says that's for your good. For everybody in here that doesn't, I'm grown, ain't nobody gonna tell me what to do. I got a question. How's all your grownness been working out in your life? I hope you still got some grown people fruit. Why you still got 12-year-old fruit yet you walking around telling everybody how grown you are? Why you borrowing from this one and begging this one and doing that if you so grown? It got quiet right there. I figured it would. You're gonna espouse how great and grown you are and how wise you are, at least have some fruit to support that. Ain't nobody gonna tell me what to do. Well, I hope you know how to tell you the right to do. And the Lord commanded us to observe these statutes, protocol, rules. And all the time when we hear rules, we think, oh, something's wrong. Ain't nothing wrong with rules. Let me tell you how you love touching them. So you love rules. Let me prove it to you. If somebody hits your car, the rules say they have to pay. Now you'd be mad than a junkyard dog if they hit your car and there was no rule in place and now you got to pay for something you didn't do. Rules are not bad. They are for our protection. Protocol is not bad. It is for our protection. That's what the Bible says. But look at this. For our good always, that he might preserve us alive as it is this day. Say, Bishop, how did he preserve them? So check this out. They come out of Egypt. Say, out. Now, in between Egypt and the promised land is the wilderness. And the wilderness is supposed to be a short amount of time. In fact, for the children of Israel, it was only supposed to be 11 days. Because they didn't listen, it turned into 40 years. Can you imagine finding out later on that it took you 40 years to get where you could have gotten in 11 days? I don't know about you, but I'd be hotter than a firecracker. Say, I'm coming out. Now, there's this in-between time. And that's where some of you are at right now. You're in between. And I need to tell you, don't you get distracted and don't you get stressed out and don't you get discouraged because you're in the in-between time. The in-between time don't last that long. Would you look at somebody and say, I'm troubled, don't last always. I know you're praying and you're saying, Bishop, it don't seem like it's working. It is working. It just starts in the root before it manifests in the fruit. I know you've been praying for your children and it seems like they're getting worse, but baby, it ain't gonna take that much longer. The in-between time is a short amount of time. Somebody holler, trouble don't last always. I'm coming out. I got in-between time, which is supposed to be a short amount of time. Then God takes me in. Say, he takes me in. Now, check this out. Once I get in, here's what happened for many Christians. They get in, then they walk out of it. And the number one reason is because they don't listen. But the number one area they don't listen is as it relates to other people. He said, Bishop Foreman, what are you talking about? Hosea 12, 13. Watch this. By a prophet, say, man of God. Please understand, you're not just sitting here. Somebody was in between the experience. They said, Bishop, I'm looking for a church. I said, well, let me give you some counsel. Most people go to church because they're looking for the accoutrements of church. Oh, I like the music. Oh, I like the kids. I like the... Listen, that ain't Bible. When I grew up, wasn't no kids' church. Kids' church was sitting next to your mama and daddy. And if you started moving too much, they didn't put your name on the screens. They had something else for you called a pinch. It wasn't a pinch. It was a pinch. Because it had more than a little pain. They pinched you so much so that you would. And then tell you, you better not cry. Well, the people know what I'm talking about. Wasn't no kids' church. Kids' church was, you better sit here, and I don't care that you can't tell what the Reverend is saying. You better sit there and act like you like it. And then God, and you better have to sit there, and that's right, Reverend. Wasn't no falling asleep. Falling asleep had a penalty. And since I'm here, wasn't no mama ain't going today. Oh no, wasn't none of that. That's a newfangled thing. Where I grew up, you went, if you in my house, as for me and for my, we will, you don't have an option when you ain't paying for nothing. But I don't feel like it. Well, then you need to feel like moving because you get, mama, I'm 12. Well, you got to go. Jesus knew what he's supposed to do. You got to. Some of y'all, you crazy negotiating with your children about serving God. We ain't negotiating. You coming to church and you better be ready before I get downstairs. Because let you not be, make me late. Well, Bishop, they don't want to go. They don't want to take dime or tap either when it's time. It ain't about what they want. The scripture says, I feel it here. The scripture says, if you spare that rod, you're going to spoil that child. The rod keeps them out of hell. And some of y'all know, if it wasn't for the discipline you received as a child, you would be locked up somewhere. You'd be messed up somewhere. You'd be jacked up. But that ain't what I want to talk about. But I just had to say that because I've never met a city with so many people that negotiate with children. Well, you know, they were tired. Well, then they can't spend the night over nowhere on no Saturday night then. No, if you teach them it's okay not to put God first, no wonder why when they don't want to, they don't. And now they got to spend their whole life learning what you could have taught them. Now they got to go to bad relationships. Now they got to have bad money. They got to make all these bad decisions when you could have just told them, oh, no, here we serve the Lord. My mom tired. Take you some vitamins. Go on the prayer line. They'll pray for you to get strength. But anyway, what I'm talking about, I'm talking about something else. Hosea 12, 13. Here it is, verse. By a prophet, say, man of God. What I'm trying to tell you was, is that God draws you to a man of God. Now, you need to understand this. Nowhere in the Bible did people, you know, I'm just trying to see where the Lord wants me to be. No, that ain't in there. Show me a text. You know, that's what I believe. Well, show me a scripture. If you can't show me a scripture, what you believe is a lie. You don't have to argue with fools. You just say, show me a scripture. Now, watch this. The scripture says, sheep know the voice of their shepherd. And check this out. Which means God divinely, before time, connects you to a man of God. Sheep could not hear well. They had to rely on their hearing, which is why everything with sheep was always about hearing, because in the natural, sheep couldn't see well. So it is in the spiritual. You can't see where you need to go, because if you could have, you wouldn't have made that mistake. That's what the Bible talks about, the blind leading the blind into a ditch. Now, God connects you to a man of God, and the connection is through his voice. Say his voice. Now, watch this. I need you to get this. In the days of the scripture, when the sheep would come together in green pastures, the sheep would sometimes intermingle and intermix. And when it was time for the sheep to now go with their shepherd on the journey, the shepherds had a distinctive call that they would make, and their sheep would respond to their call and be drawn to them. This is what he's trying to tell me. You're not here on accident. Before the foundation of time, God knew that in 2015 there was going to be a you, and he knew there was going to be a me. So in my voice, he embedded something that you need. So when God connects you to a man of God, you don't go, I'm just saying, well, I like this, I like this. It ain't about all that. You are connected divinely to a man of God. Say a man of God. And here's why that's so important. Hosea 12, 13. By a prophet, man of God, the Lord brought Israel out of Egypt. How'd they come out? No, you don't know. You missed it. How'd they come out? The man of God. Let me try the bookstore. Y'all better get this right. How'd they come out? They didn't even know there was an out. They were happy being slaves. They were happy struggling. They were happy in misery. They didn't even know there was a better life available until the Moses, the man of God, came and said, "Come on." So if it worked for them, I'm here to tell somebody it can work for you. It's some stuff that you're being brought out of, and the reason you're being brought out of is not because of how great you are, but it's because of how great our God is, seeing as much that he speaks through a man of God. Watch this. By a prophet, man of God, the Lord brought Israel out of Egypt. See, that's why some stuff you're trying to get out of, you're trying to fix on you, and it doesn't work. Because you're violating the protocol. The protocol is that it's the man of God that draws you out. How? With his voice. That's why don't you let your non-church attendant and your church hopping friends talk you into crazy stuff. That's why they messed up, jacked up, tied up, and tangled up. Because they're trying to come out of Egypt, but they're violating the protocol. That's why they get stuck. All right, watch this. And by a prophet, he was preserved. Now, he is really a they, because Israel there refers to a man, Jacob, who now fathered the children of Israel. So when it says he's really referring to a they. And by a prophet, they were preserved. Now, watch this. So what does a prophet do? He speaks. What does a man of God do? He speaks. His words. Let me contemporize it for you. His messages. He or they was preserved. Preserved in Hebrew means kept, protected, and directed. So check it out. You come out of Egypt. You have a little in-between time. You get to the promised land. But to stay there. That's why some stuff you're like, ooh, this is so great. And then all of a sudden you're like, what happened? Because you listen to get out. But you have to keep listening to stay in. Y'all not going to say nothing to me. You listen to come out of your drama. You're going to have to listen to stay out of your drama. All right? Say it's a new era. All right, number two, I got to move. Your preparation has a purpose. We're just taking four simple principles from this movie. Say, my preparation has a purpose. Now check this out. Nino and the Cash Money Brothers, which was the name of his gang, became the dominant drug ring in New York City. But anybody from New York in here, by the way, New Yorkers? All right, amen. Amen. All right, cool. But nobody thought they'd be able to succeed. Now, let me be clear. From a biblical view, in no way, shape, form, or fashion were they successful. But there's a principle I want to teach you. See, there's a principle. The movie begins with this line. Queen Latifah says this line. You're about to witness the power of street knowledge. Watch this. Check this. Touch your neighbor. Say, Bishop's going somewhere. And Nino, CMB, Cash Money Brothers, we all we got, was a group of misfits, people without sufficient education and experience. Watch this. But the issues they'd been through in life was preparation for them to build a $1 million a week operation. And we see this principle all throughout the Bible. God takes inexperienced and flawed people, but by his grace, he uses them to do great things. And can I tell you, he plans to do the exact same thing with you? I know you look back on that trouble and say, what a waste. I mean to tell you, it was not, none of it was wasted. Not one tear was wasted. Not one betrayal was wasted. Not one messed up relationship was wasted. Nothing that you've gone through is going to be wasted, because if God could do it for Nino Brown. Now, I understand, again, contextually, so that we can be accurate here. They weren't successful, but look at your neighbor and say, I need to tell you something. You actually have more in common with Nino Brown than you think. Now, watch this. Now, first off, if God only used perfect people, there'd be nobody for him to use. Now, I know a lot of Christians, their Christianity is based on their feeling of moral superiority. So what do you mean, Bishop? Well, they feel like, since I sin different than you, and you can, I can see your sin, but since you can't see my sin, I'm better than you. It's quiet in here. So what happens is subsequently people that live in glass houses start throwing stones. Not realizing that to throw the stone, you had to break your own glass. Tell them, say, you're not perfect. Tell them, say, you got some issues. But what I love about Jesus is that he knows about all your issues and knows about all your drama. And he says, listen, watch this. I'm going to heal you, correct you, and fix you as we're on our journey. You don't come get everything together to come to God. You come to God, and he will empower you to get things together. Here's how most people think. As soon as everything is right in my life, I'm going to go to church. I'm going to do right by God. I'm going to start serving. Problem is, that day never comes, because that day can't come, because you're breaking the protocol. You're trying to self-eject out of Egypt. Now check this out. Touch your neighbor. Say, you're not perfect, but he still wants to use you. Now somebody said, Bishop, what do you mean? He's not using me. He's not. Oh, yes, he is. Those people you encourage on your job, those people you give out invites to come to church, those people you share the Facebook post to, y'all not hearing me? You're already being used. Somebody say, I'm already being used. A gentleman came to me in between the worship experience and says, yesterday, when we were out doing something yesterday, he said he met some folk from the church and gave them an invite, and he said their light was shining bright. Well, he's at the worship experience today because yesterday somebody decided to be used. They're not perfect, ain't got it all together, but touch your neighbor and say, he's already using you. Stop waiting for one big day where this big thing happens. Right where you are, he can use you. But watch this. But you and I have more in common with the character Nino Brown than you might think. Because watch this. Nino's name. Watch this. I'm going to help you. Y'all, you know, you're bishops. So, you know, I ain't just going to talk the movie. I'm going to give you some depth here. Nino's name. The word Nino in its original language means God's grace. And Brown means structure, order, and truth. I don't know about you, but I am a recipient of his grace. His grace is when he gives me what I do not deserve. It is unmerited favor. Anybody know something about his grace? It's his grace that you're alive today. The wages of sin is death. So it's some stuff you've done in life where you should be dead 6 feet under. But his grace... I wish I had a church that knew about his grace. The reason you got the job you do ain't because of your resume, it's because of His grace. The reason that your life hasn't fallen apart isn't because of how perfect you are, it is because of His grace. But look at John 1:17. It says this: for the law was given through Moses, but watch this, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Now take this out. Grace is when God gives you what you don't deserve. Mercy is when God blocks from happening what you do deserve, which normally has a negative connotation. So grace gives you an opportunity you don't deserve. Mercy keeps you from going into the mess you do deserve. Grace tells you to turn right, and you turn right and don't know why. Because mercy was working to keep you out the accident. Now, check this out. Most of us like His grace. But watch this. I was telling him this morning, grace is not an incentive to continue doing the same mess over and over again. If your cell phone bill is due on the 1st, they may give you a grace period to the 15th, depending on who you use. For our Cricket subscribers in the room, you don't have that grace. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. Some of y'all tried to see if it was grace, and you didn't get nothing but truth. The truth was, this person's unavailable. They're outside of our coverage zone because they owe us some money. And until they get it right with us, truth. Some of y'all today, as soon as you get after church, you got to go have a conversation with truth. What's this? Say grace and truth. And here's what I need to understand. God says, I'm not just giving you grace, but God says, whenever grace shows up, I give you truth. See, watch this. I'm thankful that He gives me what I don't deserve. But now I've got to stop doing the foolishness that I needed the grace for in the first place. If you go to somebody and tell them, watch this, and tell them, hey, don't say it to me like that, because when you say it to me like that, that hurts me. And then they be like, okay, and then they say it again. They're no grace, but they've not been acquainted with truth. Truth says, I have an incentive to get it better, not stay in error. It got real quiet in the church. Parents, you tell your children, do this. Now, they may mess up a couple times. You may say, okay, grace. But then the truth is going to come. Some of y'all know the truth that comes. Depending on where you grew up, you had different versions of truth. Which means, because here's what people will say. Well, if you love me, you got to forgive me. Okay, I forgive you. But forgiveness doesn't mean fellowship. Forgiveness don't mean I got to be bothered with you anymore. Because I can give you grace, but whenever there is grace, there also has to be truth, which is my incentive to change. So I think there's some people in here that say, Father, thank you for your grace. We need it. But thank you that grace also showed up with truth, which means there's some areas I got to do better. And I got to start doing better, not tomorrow, but I got to start doing it right now. Grace is not an excuse to remain in error. And here's how people will do it. Since y'all ain't saying nothing, I'm going to talk longer. See, if you'd say amen, I'd move on. Here's what people say. Well, God knows my heart. That ought to be the scary part. So, Bishop, what do you mean? Scripture says in Jeremiah that the heart is deceitfully wicked. Do you understand what deceit means? Deceit means you want some of my Kool-Aid. Now, what am I holding? A bottle of water. Now, some of you are like, Bishop, what's in the water? That's lemon and lime. Make it taste good. Comes like a meal, you know. Now watch this. Deceit says, would you like some of my red Kool-Aid? No, you don't get it. Deceit is intentionally misleading about what reality is. The Bible says your heart, which in Hebrew is the word lev, which means your mind, and Greek is the word cardia, which means the seat of all decisions, which means mind. It's deceitfully wicked. It's deceitful and desperately wicked, excuse me. Above what? The devil. All things. Who can know it? Watch this. Your mind will tell you, you like that red Kool-Aid? But it's not red Kool-Aid. Your feelings will tell you so-and-so don't care about you. It'll put something up that's totally wrong and totally deceiving. Everybody's against you. Well, even if that was true, if I got the one I need, if God be for me, but touch your neighbor and say, that's not true. It's more people for you than it is against you. And you got to stop focusing on what your deceitful mind is telling you. All right, watch this. Say grace and truth. Grace is our incentive to do better, not to remain in error. And watch this. And truth says, I can't use the opportunities I'm given, and I can't take them lightly. I can't play with life. Matter of fact, there's a few of y'all in here, a few of us in here. Well, you said, I done wasted enough of my days. Who am I talking to? So I don't just have grace, but I also have truth. All right, third principle. Now, this is perhaps the most profound. Don't play with yesterday. Don't play with yesterday. Pookie, who was played by Chris Rock, was a crackhead that was put in rehab. And as he recovers, he offers to help bring down Nino. Now you see Pookie on the screen. Ain't Chris Rock, he came a long way. That's his character, though. Now, Air Bloodline has one of those. Yours, too. I don't care whether you grew up in the Hamptons or the hood. You got one of them. Now, check this out. Pookie, he was a crackhead. That's what the terminology was used. I'm not saying that in a derogatory sense. That's the terminology used to describe what he did. He was put in rehab. Now, watch this. Scotty, who was the detective, played by Ice-T, instead of arresting him, he says, I'm going to put him in rehab. And he puts him in rehab. And as Chris, Pookie, is recovering, watch this. He offers to help bring Nino down. Now, he ain't about 2 weeks off the stuff. Talking about, let me go back up in the house with the stuff. All right, since you ain't saying nothing, see, I done told you how to get me to move on, but you keep going saying nothing. You 2 weeks out of a bad relationship. How in the world are you talking about I'm ready for a fresh one? You ain't healed from your wounds yet. You're still bleeding. You're still bloody. You ain't ready. You still mad at some church folk. You still got some bitterness against some family members. What's this? He just barely off the stuff. And watch this. He says, well, let me help bring Nino down, man. You know I got to do this, man. Let me help bring Nino down. And Scotty's like, man, you owe a lot of people. Watch this. And against Scotty's better judgment and against the disapproval of his leadership. I figured they'd get quiet there. Because Scotty's commanding officer told him, you're crazy if you're going to put a crackhead back in a room full of crack. He's not ready for that yet. Yeah, y'all not hearing what I'm saying. His leader disapproved of it. It was against his better judgment. But Scotty makes Pookie an informant, and Pookie relapses, and he dies at the hands of what he was delivered from, because Pookie wasn't ready to be around a room full of crack, because while he was out of Egypt, Egypt wasn't all the way out of him, because coming out of Egypt can happen in a moment, but Egypt coming out of you takes time. And that's why for some of you, you keep repeating the same cycles in life, because you try to step into stuff that you ain't ready for. You try to go back around the people. Y'all not going to say nothing to me. You try to go back around the same old dead friends, same old dead relationships, same old dead stuff, talking about I'm ready. You ain't ready just because you shouted one time at church. You come out of Egypt in a moment, but Egypt comes out of you over time. Watch this. I'm almost through. Watch this. Now, here's the reality. You don't know you're free from it until you're tempted by it. It's easy to say I'm free when there's no temptation. But you don't know if you're free until you can look at temptation and say, Okay. All right. Watch this. I figured y'all do that, so I wrote this in here. Watch this. Not just the obvious sins. Because some of you are thinking, that's right, Bishop. Talk to those people that used to use drugs. Talk to them, Bishop. I want to talk to you not about the obvious sins, but the subtle ones, like how you treat people. Okay. Responding like the old you versus the new you. Oh, you do understand that sin. You do understand saying you love God, but treating people like trash is wrong. Oh, it got real quiet right there. I figured it would. Okay, what about the subtle things like acting like a dog and returning to vomit? The scripture says that a dog is known because it goes and returns to its own vomit. It threw it up because it knew it wasn't good for it, yet it goes back to it. Okay, he said, Bishop, what kind of vomit you talking about? You're stinking thinking. You do understand that your logic is your lid. But Bishop, that never works out for me. You do understand that, Pookie, come here, Pookie. Bishop, I'm just tired. Well, you're tired because that's your confession, but that's your confession because that's your belief, and that's your belief, so it becomes your lid. Because as a man thinks in his heart, mind, so is he, which means as a man is, so are his thoughts, which means the extent to which I can go starts here. Are you still here? I said, are you still here? All right. Maybe it's relationships. You keep saying, I keep just finding the same kind of person. Message. The problem ain't the people you finding. You need to say, what is it in me that keeps attracting that person? It's quiet in this church. All right, say amen, because I feel a push right there. And I don't want to. Maybe it's reverting to old habits. See, you are who you really are when you're stressed, when you're under pressure. And often we revert to our default. Which is why Jesus doesn't just want to fix fruit, he deals with root. The root is your default. You know the default? The default is the default setting. I had to replace one of my TVs the other day because the TV, it caught the devil in it, and it wasn't doing right. And I don't believe in keeping problems longer than the day. So I said, you got until tonight when I get back to act right, and if not, I'll trade you in a minute. You must not know about me. So when I got home, still had the devil in it. And it was a trip because the devil was, let me be clear. TVs can't get devils. I'm being facetious. Point is that it wasn't working. So when I got back, it was a subtle thing because it would come on. It would act like it was working. But it wasn't connecting to the source it needed to connect to. It'd be obvious if the TV didn't turn on. Something totally different when it looked like it was something it wasn't. Whole nother teaching. So watch this. So I had to replace it. And then to the new TV, I had to reset all the defaults. I had to change all the defaults. And I was pretty upset about it because my Wi-Fi password for the TV to connect to the thing is like 400 characters. It's like the whole alphabet plus every number forward and reverse plus your cousin's name and all that kind of stuff. So I was mad about it because I'm like, this is going to take me, it's going to take a while for somebody to get this information in here. Now, watch this. Say default. Under pressure, what is your default? Is it to cuss and act a fool? Don't look at me with that stony voice. Because some of y'all, listen, watch this. Some of y'all, I can tell the cusses. Used to be. Come on, call that thing. Come on, used to be. I can tell you are. Because when there's certain things I say, when I'm getting extra real, y'all like, say it, Bishop! Woo! Because I said what you've been thinking. I'm almost through. Watch this. Say default. So is your default to go eat more than you should? Or to not eat enough? I'm not eating anything. Are you going to pass out? You going to eat your sandwich or something? Because if you pass out, I'm not picking you up. I'm not doing that. I got to be at work on time. Watch this. Pookie reverted to his default because he played with yesterday. And he reminds me of a woman in the Bible named Mary Magdalene. Now, Magdalene wasn't her last name. It was the place she was from. She was Mary from Magdala, but they ascribed the surname to her Magdalene to indicate her difference in the other Marys, because Mary was a very prominent and dominant name of the time. She relapsed after being set free, and she messed up big more than once. Say, Bishop, how do you know that? Let me show you in the text. Mark 16 and 9. Now, when he rose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to who? Mary Magdalene. Now notice, this is after the crucifixion. This is the day of the resurrection, the day of first fruits, this is called. He appears not to Peter, not to James, not to John, not to his own mother. He appears to this Mary Magdalene. But look at what Mark adds, whom he had cast out seven demons. After years of Mary following Jesus, this is at the end of Jesus' 3.5-year ministry. At the end of following, or after years of Mary following Jesus, when he resurrects, the number of unclean spirits are mentioned. Now, you have to say, why would he add the number? What's the significance? Why didn't he just say, out of whom he cast unclean spirits? The Bible records it that way in other places. Look at the neighbor and say, why? Look at the other neighbor and say, why? Luke 11 and 24 tells us why. When an unclean spirit goes out of a man, he goes through dry places. Now, let me make it clear. A lot of times when we talk about spirits and demons and stuff like this, people can sometimes get all confused about this. Now, in its very rudimentary form, there are levels to this, pneumatology, demonology, etc., but I want to keep this super simple for us today. The word spirit in Greek deals with a mindset. Say mindset. All right? So when it says unclean spirit, it's dealing with an unclean or perverse mindset, or how the mind was set. Got it? That's what it means in its root form. So I don't want you to think, you know, demons going around with pitchforks and red suits and stuff like that. That's Greek mythology. That's not Bible. When an unclean spirit goes out of a man, he goes through dry places seeking rest. And now what's the rest he's trying to find? He's trying to find a match for his set. On time. And I return, and finding none, he says, I will return to the house from which I came. Notice that the spirit refers to the person as a house, which means the spirit dwells, takes up residence, and begins to live through you as if it is you. Oh, God, I think I got a little time here. Have you ever noticed that certain people with certain spirits and certain mindsets, you could have met one of them, and then when you meet somebody else that has that same thing in them, you're like, I didn't met you before. I know you have a different body, you have a different face, you have a different, but I've met you before. Watch. All right, watch this. And when he comes, he finds it swept and put in order. Wait a minute. Grace and truth. Nino and Brown. But look at verse 26. Then he goes and takes with him seven other spirits more wicked than himself, and they enter and dwell there. And the last state of that man is worse than the first state of that man. So you said, Bishop, how do you know that Mary had messed up more than once? Because when they mentioned, and Mark wasn't the only one to mention it, but when they mentioned it, they were specific about saying the number Jesus had cast out of her to indicate that Mary had messed up big more than once. It's quiet here. I don't know about you, but there's some mess ups I've had more than once. Would you look at your neighbor and say, be real about it? There's some mistakes you've had more than once, and that's because with any movie, if it's a good movie, there's normally a sequel. So what happens is you'll think you're delivered from something, and it'll leave you alone for a while. But then that thing comes back around with friends that are stronger than they were in an attempt to pull you back in it. But I dare you to look over at your neighbor and say, I'm not the one for that. I'm not. No, look at that other neighbor. Say, I'm not the one for that. If he's brought me out of that, I intend to. But watch this. Let me teach it to you. Because, watch this, I'm almost through. They come out, and the scripture says that they're stronger than him. Which is why, when you play with yesterday, there's times you handle something once, you're like, I got that. Then it comes around a second time, and now you acting brand new, like you don't know. Okay, y'all, they ain't gonna say nothing to me, so let me talk to you, because they ain't saying nothing to me. You ever met people like that, where they acting brand new like they don't know? They already know Bobo is no good. But they sitting there acting like, well, the Lord can change. If God's presence didn't change Judas, don't for one second think that his presence is going to change Bobo or row, row, row your boat. Gently down. Don't. Watch. Watch this. Watch this. So we know Mary messed up. Say she messed up. So watch this. If you rebellious, if you were rebellious, then listen to spiritual leadership. Don't play with that. Because when you open the door, it's seven times worse. If you were blank, whatever the blank is, touch your neighbor and say, don't play with it. See, this explains why people have great falls, because they played with yesterday and thought they can handle it, but they didn't know that it was seven times stronger than it was when it first came. But what I love about Jesus is that even though Mary had messed up big more than once, somewhere in private, Jesus cast out her mess so that she could be a public success. It was off the books and it was in the background. No, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? Because the only time we read anything about stuff coming out of Mary was at the end of Jesus' ministry. And the only reason it's mentioned is to send the principle to us. But notice, it doesn't call out the seven. It gives you the number, but it doesn't tell you what they were. Which means God said, Mary, you've been so good. Now, he told us what Judas' issues were. But he didn't tell us what Mary's issues were. Because Mary, touch your neighbor and say, I think there's a Mary in you. Now, even if it's a man, come on, you understand what I'm saying? It's a spiritual principle. Don't get all uptight. Come on. Bishop, what are you saying? Because Jesus dealt with her stuff in private. And I think there's a few grateful people in here that when Jesus could have put your stuff on blast, could have put your stuff on Front Street, he took you behind the scenes and he covered you. Is there any, I got a witness here. Is there anybody in here where God has covered you and he's kept you and fixed your stuff in private? I was ministering this last week to some pastors. And whenever I talk to pastors, I like to be real with pastors, because pastors, you know, we're strong because we got to be strong and all that. But sometimes pastors get tired, and they get tired because they help a lot of people in private. But those people turn around and betray them in public. Y'all ain't gonna say nothing to me. They help a lot of people in private. It's a lot of stuff pastors have cleaned up. It's a lot of drama that pastors have handled in the back room. It's a lot of stuff pastors didn't tell the church about. It's a lot, and they help the people back here. But then all of a sudden, once the people look like they got it together, they want to act ungrateful. But what I love about Mary, there's something about Mary. What I love about Mary is that even though she messed up over and over and over again, she became the most dedicated and the most loyal to Jesus because she was the most grateful. Are there any grateful? Oh, God. See, you're not grateful because maybe you think you deserve for him to get you out. But it's some of us that understand, if it had not been for the Lord that was on us, and I'm glad about the fact that he fixed me in the back. What's this? Mary, I'm on Sue. Mary, she was the most loyal and most dedicated to Jesus because she was most grateful. And ungrateful people are normally unusable people and normally unstable people. If you see somebody unstable, it's normally because they're ungrateful. Because grateful people don't play with the stability they get. She didn't forget everything he'd done for her like some church folk do. I figured he'd get quiet there. She was just happy that he let her around. See, a lot of people, a lot of church folk, especially if you've been in church for a while, you know, you have this entitlement mentality. I'm doing the church a favor. You ain't doing nobody no favor. There's plenty of monkeys at the zoo. Bishop, you calling me? Listen, don't start that with me. We act like, God, you better get me out of this, God. God, I've been to church all four Sundays this month. And we can sometimes forget to be grateful, appreciative. Thank you. When I'm driving, there's one thing that really, really bothers me. It's when I let somebody over and they don't give me the thank you hand. Now, I understand I don't own the road. Now, my taxes help pay for it, but I understand I don't own it technically. But since I gave you some grace, the least you could do is say, thank you. Mary was grateful. Watch this. She was so grateful. She was so grateful that she's mentioned more than the other apostles in the Bible. And she was even given the honorific title of the apostle to the apostles. Because when Jesus rose, before he appeared to Peter, James, John, or even his mother Mary, he appears to Mary Magdalene and tells her to go tell them. He tells the grateful one to go tell the church. Now, if I had time, I'd deal with that. I don't. Peter wasn't there. All the people on payroll weren't there. All the people in his staff weren't there. But this one grateful woman that said, I'm so thankful that even though I messed up big, he still wanted me and he still loves me and he still uses me. And that's the same for you and I. Luke 8:1 says this, now it came to pass afterward that he went through every city and village preaching and bringing the glad tidings of the kingdom of God. Which means Jesus, they couldn't keep him in one place. His assignment was too massive to be stuck in one city. And the 12 were with him. Now, that tells us that Jesus wasn't poor. You can't have 12 full-time staff and have a traveling crusade department. And you got a full-time treasurer, Judas, full-time head of security, Peter. Oh, no, I know Peter was security because Peter looked for the knife. When something went down, Peter was like, I got the knife though, Jesus. I got the knife. What's this? Verse 2. And certain women who had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities, Mary called Magdalene, out of whom had come, look at Luke mentioned it, 7 demons. And Joanna, the wife of Chusa, Herod's steward, and Susanna, and many others who provided from him for their substance. Watch this. Look at me, Harvest. They were his biggest financial benefactors. They laid down their lives to go travel with Jesus, not as part of his staff, but because they were so grateful of what he'd done for them. There was a day you didn't have to pay everybody for everything they should do just because they're grateful. There was a day people, you know, if you grew up in the kind of church where to pay for stuff, they murdered chickens and fish. Fish dinners, y'all like, oh my God, what happened to the fish? Fish dinners, chicken dinners, okay. Now, a lot of times, watch this, if you grew up in that, the church didn't buy that food. The people bought the food and cooked the food and gave the money to the church. Listen, what's the point you're trying to make? Mary was so grateful that the scripture says she provided, and these other women provided from her own substance. They were his greatest givers because she was grateful. When you've been delivered greatly, you should give greatly. When you're loved greatly, you should give greatly. See, I don't know about you, but when it comes time for special days, those are a big deal to me. You know, birthdays and holidays and something like that. Now, you say, Bishop, why is that a big deal to you? Because on days you can show honor, it's important to show honor. And if you're ungrateful, some of you parents, you know what I'm talking about, because your children, you just knew they were going to have something for you. You still mad at some of them. He thought, now boy, after all I did for you, and I got to sit up here and ask you, say I'm grateful. Say it again, say I'm grateful. She played with yesterday, but what I love about it is Jesus still cleaned her up in the back. You don't know none of her 7. Question, what's your 7? For some of y'all, it's 7, 7, 7, 9, 3, 11. It's more than 7. You got some extra digits. Say, be honest. See, you're at Harvest, so you don't have to do that fake pretending stuff here. Gross, don't do that. What's your 7? 7 spirits, mindsets, mentalities. What's your 7? What's your 7? Look at the neighbor and say, you have some. But what I love about Jesus is he looks at you with your 7 and says, come on.
But Jesus, I'm not good enough. Shut your mouth. Come on.
Fourth and final principle from this movie, you're going to reap what you sow. You're going to reap what you sow. Now watch this. If you sow a lie, don't be shocked when the folk tell the truth about you. If you sow disloyalty, see, I never understood disloyal people. And because I don't understand the mentality of disloyalty, but I was reading Steve Jobs' biography or listening to it. I like audiobooks, and I was listening to it. And again, that's more of a grown folks book, some chapters. And I was listening to it, and one of the ladies said Steve Jobs was actually raised by adoptive parents. And you know Steve Jobs, Apple, your phone. Now, what's this? He was actually iTunes, all that. He was actually raised by adoptive parents. What was interesting is they talked about how he was an abandoner. How he would walk away from responsibilities. How he'd walk away from the things he's supposed to do. How he'd walk away. Even a daughter he had that he just walked away from and abandoned. This is in his biography. It's his story. It's in his book. And I was listening. There's a line in there that was powerful. It says, "He who is abandoned becomes an abandoner." And I was on the airplane shaking my head like, yeah, I don't. Now watch this. I need to catch this. It's interesting because I don't really understand the pathology of disloyal people, because loyalty is important to me. When I'm loyal, you can take that check to the bank and it cashes. They'd be like, oh, Bishop said, okay, cool. And so, consequently, because I sow that, I expect to reap that from people. What's interesting is to see the disloyal. Anybody ever had people be disloyal to you? Now, here's what you need to understand. If you sow that, you're going to reap that. But now I have a better understanding as to why people do that. They do it because it was done. Somebody dropped them, so they don't see any big deal with dropping. Somebody didn't honor them, so they don't see any big deal. Not. You got real quiet right there. Apparently, I'm in the Kool-Aid. I'm in your red Kool-Aid. Well, I'll say this. If you sow being judgmental, be prepared to reap that. What do you mean, judgmental? You're looking at everybody else's specs in their eye, and you've avoided the forest in your eye. Well, Bishop, you need to preach against this. Well, let's start with you. You want to preach against stuff, that's fine. Let's start with your stuff. Bishop, you need to tell the sinners. Okay, let's start with you then. You want to beat people down, let's start with you. You're the first one to get kicked. Doesn't ever say, don't be judgmental. And let me tell you something, I'm through. I'm just taking a little liberty. Watch this. If you're judgmental, what I've discovered, the harvest of that is often you becoming what you judged. So you talked about somebody else's daughter. So oftentimes the harvest for that, you talked about somebody else's marriage. All right, keep it moving. Yes, sir. Okay. What's your neighbor say? You're going to reap what you sow. Now, some people think they can treat God and his church any old kind of way. You know, his church is the people. Some people think you can treat God's people any old kind of way, but and get away with it. But in Galatians 6:7, it says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. Here it is, and I'm closing. Scotty Ice-T revealed that it was his mother that Nino had killed as a teen. And after being captured, Nino was sentenced to 1 year in jail. After all Nino's done, he's sentenced to 1 year in jail. Now, if I had time, I could teach you another principle about the dangers of division. Because everything Nino had worked to build was taken down because G Money got himself confused with Nino and thought that the attention he was getting was attention because of him, but they didn't realize the attention he was getting was because of him. But I don't have time to deal with that today, but that's the name, said be careful with division. There's some people, let them, when if they're walking out of your life, let them walk out because they're divisive. They're causing division. You got some family members, they cause division. So-and-so ain't coming. Good, thank you, Jesus. Ugh, I didn't want them bringing that division up in here no how. When division shows up, God leaves. Back to the teaching. Here it is. I'm through. Nino sentenced to 1 year in jail. Think about it. They've murdered people. They've had this huge drug ring. They've done all of these unspeakable, vile acts. And Nino gets 1 year in jail. And it's amazing because Scotty captures him. And as he captures him, he's beating him up. He's beating him up. He's beating him up. And he says, I'm going to hurt you. And the police come and say, listen, Scotty, it's not worth it. And Scotty's like, oh, no, it's worth it. Nino said, used to always say, it's never personal, it's just business. Scott is like, no, this ain't business, this is very personal. Because that woman you killed in that gang initiation, that was my mother. He's beating him down, they pull him off, they're in the trial, they sentence him to 1 year. And it looks like he's not going to pay for what he's done. And as Nino walks out of the courtroom arrogantly, thinking he was just going to get away with everything he'd done. And he walks over to talk to the reporters outside the courtroom. A man comes and takes Nino's life. Nino falls over the balcony to his death because the reaping is always greater than the sowing. My challenge to us with this principle is this. Twofold. Somebody say twofold. Number one, don't worry about people that have done you wrong. Oftentimes, God waits until they get arrogant. And that's when he comes around and say, oh, by the way, you got a harvest to reap here. So don't worry about getting even. Somebody said, let that go. Let that bitterness go. Let that unforgiveness go. Let that anger go. Let it go because God will not be mocked. But secondly, we have to be careful what we sow. We have to ask ourselves the question, do we want to reap that? And the harvest is always greater than the seed. Do you want to reap how you treated some people? I'm just asking questions. Preguntas in Spanish. If we don't want to reap it, that tells us we shouldn't do what? Sow it. Question today. How many of us have sown some stuff? And let's just talk about, let's not even deal with the rest of your life. Let's deal with the first 7 months of this year. How many in the first 7 months, and what's today? 19? First 7 months, 19 days of this year. And what, 13 hours, 12 hours. How many of us have sown some stuff and we're like, probably shouldn't have done that. Let's be honest. Now, if you haven't sown anything, and you got it, you that perfect, you that good, well, then you do need to put your hand up because you just lied. So, found something. Now check this out. I love the fact that the Bible says, I'm talking so because I want us to get it. Whatever you sow reap. Sow means I put it in one day, I plant it. It takes time for it to harvest and come back. What I love about the text is he said, whatever a man sows, he shall reap. But he did not explicitly say that I could not unsow. You missed it. He didn't say that that was the end of the story. There's some ambiguity in the text which suggests to me he left it that way on purpose. Because if I can sow it, he didn't say as a man does, shall it be done to him. He said as a man sows. He used agricultural terminology to make it clear that if a farmer sows a seed, it takes time for him to get a harvest from that seed. But if you sowed something negative, anybody sow something negative? If you've sown something negative, the scripture would suggest to me that we can uproot what we've sown to stop the harvest from coming. You missed it. Let me prove it to you. It works that way. Watch this. Even with seed of good words. You speak good words. You speak words of faith over your life. Homo legeo is the word, which means the same. Homo the same. Legeo, word, which means when you say what God says about you. So when you say the word that God says about you, you can speak that. But watch that. The same way you spoke those words, you can now speak negative words and cancel out what you spoke.
So if it works on that ear, it can also work on the other ear. Which means if there's some stuff we've sown that we need to stop the harvest of, I got good news for you, because you can do it, not tomorrow, but you can do it right here, and you can do it right now.
Apparently, ain't nobody in here sown nothing.
If you got some stuff you need to unsow right now, the same way you sowed it through your words, we're going to unsow it right now. Somebody say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I unsow through the power of my confession, my negative words, negative actions, anything I've done that would produce a negative harvest. By faith, I unsow it. I dig it up in Jesus' name.
Give God praise wherever you are.
I said, give God praise wherever you are.
Now watch this. Now, the Lord said, do it this morning. I'm going to do it, and so I'm going to do it again at this experience. Now, touch your neighbor. Say, that's a good start. But watch this. There's some stuff that you need to go unsow, because you need to go to whom or whatever, and you need to fix it. If it's some folks you've been talking about, you ain't going to say, hey, got a minute? Cause watch this. I'm telling this morning. Keith Sweat was in this movie, and he's part of New Jack Swinger. And Keith Sweat, he was known for this thing they call in music. They call it the cry. That's why all his songs, he sound like he crying. Sound like he whining. He begging. Man, you know, all this. Don't look at me. You don't know. Some of y'all don't know. Come on. Now, what's this? The old you. The you that used to wear Jerry curls and jumpsuits and stuff. If you still got one, amen. We thank God for you, amen. You better whip it. Make that thing work, amen. Just keep that juice off these good church chairs, though, amen. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to his name. Okay, watch this. And the Lord said, son, tell him, plead with them. I said, okay, Lord. He said, son, tell them that whatever they can get right today, they need to get it right today. Before a harvest of the hell they've been sowing shows up. It's a song we used to sing often. We haven't sang it in a little while. We said, this is my season for faith, grace, and favor. This is my season to reap what I've sown. Okay, you understand what you're saying? It ain't just the financial seeds you've sown. But all the mess, the drama, the lying, the stealing, the deceit, you're calling that in too. And he said, son, tell them. I said, yes, sir. He said, tell them whatever they can fix today, fix it today. If you got some people you need to go apologize to, do it today. Some of you, it's some folks, they've passed on and you still held a grudge at them. You need to go have a conversation with Jesus and you need to let that go today. Got to have it with Jesus, because they ain't here. You can't talk to them. And if you are, you need to come see me immediately. Somebody say, fix it today. For some of you, you need to forgive yourselves today. You're still mad at you, and you go around with this secret love-hate relationship for yourself. Sometimes you like you, sometimes you don't. You need to fix that today. He said, son, tell them to fix it today. He said, because they've got an opportunity. There's a window of time. There's a portal of time today to correct whatever it is so that they don't reap the harvest of that. And what you ought to be giving God praise about is he's given you an opportunity to fix it. You didn't hear this message on accident today. God says, I'm trying to help you help yourself. Before some of that stuff comes back. So, Father, today, please forgive us, sir. For all of our sin, all of our foolishness, all of our unrighteousness. Father, we know that you're faithful and just to forgive us. Thank you that your blood covers us, makes us whiter than snow. We are loved. We are loved unconditionally by you.
And we don't just have grace, we have truth, which is our incentive to do better and not stay in error. We have truth. And so today, in the name of Jesus, give us the grace to fix whatever we need to fix, to apologize to whomever we need to apologize, to release whatever unforgiveness, hurt, bitterness, whatever it is, to release it today. In Jesus' name. First thing, as you're in this worship experience today, I taught a little longer than normal, but did you learn something? Isn't that amazing how God can use a movie to teach principles? Hallelujah. Today, if you're in this worship experience, the first thing you got to get right is your relationship with Jesus. 2,000 years ago, God stepped in a body. The body was named Jesus. That body got on a cross, paid the price for you and I so that you and I could have life, which is eternal life and life more abundantly. That's Zoe. That's the kind of life we live here. It doesn't mean a life with no problems. It just means that now even our problems have purpose. And today, if you need to become a Christian, there's forgiveness for you. Bishop Foreman, I've made some mistakes. Give me two more weeks. Let me just work on myself and I'm going to get it. No. You don't get it right to come to God. You come to God, and He's what gets us right. And what I love about it is that, look at your neighbor and say, He's patient. As long as you keep getting up saying, I may have made some mistakes yesterday, but today is a new day. And this is the day that the Lord has made. Maybe I messed up yesterday, but it's a new day today. And the scripture says, I got new mercies today. Today, if you need to become a Christian for the first time, there's forgiveness for you. Secondly, if you've given your life to the Lord before, but you've not been faithful in serving Him, if you've not been a faithful Christian, I got good news for you. There is forgiveness for you. How awesome a God we serve. Man, that Mary Magdalene thing ought to have you just crying in your car when you're driving somewhere, or crying in the vestibule after church because, you say, Bishop, why would I do that? Because she had a long list of stuff, but He never even cares to tell us what it is. Because she was loyal and dedicated. And He says, it's none of your business what I dealt with her in private about. All you need to know is that she was the first one I came to show myself to. Peter, who represented the church, and James, who was the bishop of Jerusalem, later on, they weren't there. He used Mary to go announce something to the church. Somebody will catch it. Today, if you need to become a Christian, recommit yourself to Jesus. There's love and forgiveness for you. I don't care how bad you've messed up. We've all messed up. We've all made mistakes. Today's your day. You're at Harvest. Nobody's going to judge you. We're not going to beat you up. We're not going to throw you down. That's not who we are. And I know a lot of Christians want to be known for what they're against, but our core values say we're known for what we're for. The Holy Ghost does the changing of people. Not you kicking them around and beating them down. People did that to you, and you still ain't changed. So today, if you need to get things right with God and become a Christian and recommit yourself to Him on the count of three, wherever you're at, if you're at the Royal Campus or watching online or any Roku site, I want you to throw your hands up. And when you do, we're going to shout and celebrate for you because we were all once standing in that same place. And today is a fresh start. I told you, you're going to turn the page. And this is your moment to turn that page. On the count of three, throw that hand up and we're going to shout and celebrate for you. If you need to become a Christian and recommit yourself to Jesus. If you're unsure, that's your answer. Be sure, put your hand up. One, two, three. If that's you, throw that hand up. I see you. 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 Oh, come on, Harvest. Give God praise for every hand. That's somebody's mother, somebody's brother, somebody's cousin, and their life matters. Their life matters just like yours. Everybody, lay your hands on yourself and say this to me. Say, Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for dying in my place because of this belief, because of this confession. If this is my first time praying this, I am now a Christian. My spirit is born again. It'll take some time for my flesh to conform. But my spirit is out of Egypt. And I decree that it won't be that much time for my flesh to make the journey also. I commit myself to you. I'm like Mary Magdalene. Thank you for handling me in the back.
Jesus. Thank you for not quitting on me. Thank you for not walking out on me. Even when I walked out on you. From this moment forward, it is the beginning of the greatest days of my life. In Jesus' name. Would you give God praise now all in this place? I said, would you give God praise all in this place that he'll never walk out on you? He didn't give up on you. He kept on believing in you. Listen, if you just became a Christian and recommitted yourself to Jesus, wherever you're at, I want you to take out your mobile phone and text the word decision to the phone number 5976.